My name is Nicole MartinRogers. I'm a senior research manager at Wilder Research. A big focus of my work is about designing applied research studies to answer important questions that will help to address critical social issues. One topic I've been hearing a lot about lately is data disaggregation. In 2017, my colleagues Dr. Paul Matesik and Dr. Richard Chase and I each had the opportunity to attend one session in a three-part series that was sponsored by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and hosted by PolicyLink. At these gatherings, we met with other national experts to discuss the current status of data disaggregation and to identify key recommendations for moving these efforts forward. I'd like to take a few minutes to tell you what social scientists mean by this term data disaggregation and why we think it is so important. The word disaggregation just means to split things into groups. Data disaggregation by race and ethnicity means two things. First, it could mean breaking out broad race categories into more specific ethnic or cultural groups. So Asian American could become Hmong, Vietnamese, Lao, Chinese, Korean, and so on. The same thing for American Indian, which could become Ojibwe, Lakota, Dakota, Ho-Chunk, and so on. You could break out any of the five major race or ethnic groups that are used by the U.S. Census Bureau in this same way. Second, data disaggregation could mean analyzing one or more racial or ethnic groups against other demographic variables. So, for example, the category of African American could be broken out into different age and gender groups. Or we could divide groups by disability status, primary language, education level, income, homeownership status, zip code of residence, and so on. As you can imagine, an almost infinite number of configurations of this are possible, but not all of them are interesting or useful. So why do we care about disaggregating data by race and ethnic groups? Like most applied researchers, one of the questions I often try to answer is, how are an individual's or group's characteristics related to their outcomes? In many cases, a broad racial or ethnic category like the five main groups used by the U.S. Census Bureau might not be useful to help us understand or unpack health outcomes or other complex social issues. In some cases, using broad race categories in social science research can actually reinforce stereotypes. For example, in health research, when we look at race compared against many health behaviors, we can see that people from different racial groups have different behaviors on average. But that doesn't help us to understand why people from different groups behave differently. Learning more about social determinants of health, such as how different communities where people live affect their health by providing access or not to things like healthy food and safe housing, and also learning more about the traditional healthy lifestyle practices of different groups can help to inform solutions rather than just continuing to observe the same health disparities over and over again, what I like to call admiring the problem. In other words, knowing about people's characteristics that actually affect if and how they receive a service or how they experience a certain thing can help to inform policy, programs, and efforts to improve equity. Often, broad racial categories don't give us enough information. And an important reminder that we don't only want to focus on people's problems or needs here. Data disaggregation can also help us to better understand the assets, strengths, and resilience factors that may be particular to a specific cultural group. Here is an example of a case where data disaggregation for the group of Asian American is useful and relevant. It's likely that a newly arrived Karen refugee will have a different health status, different health needs and behaviors, and different health outcomes when compared with a third-generation Hmong Minnesotan. And in general, a refugee is going to have different healthcare access than an uninsured immigrant, than an insured immigrant, or an American citizen. If we only look at race as defined by the census, we would miss these important factors that affect outcomes. It is critical to have a more nuanced picture of people's characteristics if we want to ensure that people have access to the services they need, if we want to provide culturally responsive services, and if we want to better understand how to improve quality of life for all Minnesotans. I should briefly pause here to remind all of us that race is a social construct. It is not a genetic or physical characteristic that we can measure by testing someone's blood or DNA. Race is defined differently in different political jurisdictions and in the same jurisdiction over time. Race was basically invented as a way to categorize people and to help make meaning of the world. What this means is that there is no one right way to do this. Things have changed a lot over time, and we can continue to evolve and improve our methods for collecting this type of information to ensure it's relevant and useful, given our current circumstances and realities. The U.S. government has significantly changed the way it categorizes and asks people about their race over time. We can see how these changes may be related to various political interests at the time. For example, at the start of the census in 1790, the only races that were measured were free whites, all other free persons, and slaves. On the other end of the timeline, the subcategories of Asian Indian and Vietnamese were just added since 1980. The categories used by the Census Bureau reflect larger national trends that may or may not correspond to local changes, such as the substantial growth over the past several decades among Minnesota's East and West African groups and many Southeast Asian communities. There were several really cool changes that the Census Bureau was discussing for the 2020 census, including combining the Hispanic ethnicity and race questions and adding a new racial category of Middle Eastern and North African. People from that region of the world or who have ancestry from that region of the world are currently classified as white on the U.S. Census. Unfortunately, on January 26th, the Census Bureau announced that they will not be making these changes for the 2018 census test or for the 2020 decennial census, despite the very positive feedback they received during preliminary testing of these new question formats. This was an administrative decision. The 2020 census will instead use the 2010 census format for race and ethnicity questions with just a few minor updates. This will go to Congress for approval in March 2018, and it seems to be pretty much a done deal. Although the decision about the Census 2020 appears to have been made already, this is an area where we can always advocate within our own organizations and at all levels of government for better data gathering and appropriate data disaggregation to inform program design and delivery and informed policy making. Minnesota Compass will provide detailed information for several of the largest cultural communities in Minnesota using census detailed subgroups. If you are doing work to disaggregate data for your own organization or community, I have just a few suggestions that might help you as you begin the process. First, you need to understand what data are currently available and what it would take to get to the level of data you're hoping for. Then ask yourself, isn't it reasonable to make that much effort to get the additional data? Every circumstance needs to be evaluated to determine the best options for moving forward, but don't forget to refer back to your key research questions to be sure that the categories and subcategories you define for disaggregation actually line up with the questions you're asking. And ultimately, will this additional information you'll obtain through disaggregation help you to understand whatever situation you're trying to explain or to make a more informed decision? I prefer to use both qualitative and quantitative data and to seek out information from multiple sources when I'm trying to unpack complex social issues. One source of data, even if it's disaggregated, rarely tells us enough about an individual's or group's experience to be used for major decisions. And this really importantly includes incorporating the perspectives of those who are directly affected by the issue, as they're the experts about their own circumstances and experiences. Getting input from community members about how to disaggregate data and how to interpret the data and make meaning or generate recommendations are all critical steps to getting disaggregation right. There are also many challenges to disaggregating data well. For example, while we recognize the importance of collecting more nuanced data about people, at the same time we should acknowledge the difficult political climate in which people may feel unsafe to disclose information about their ethnic origins, immigration status, and related topics. And of course, we know that this fear among certain groups about disclosing their information might be related to their fear of actually accessing services they need or their ability to access services they need, which could contribute over time to even greater disparities and worse outcomes among these groups. Good applied social science research requires a grasp on historical context and intersectionality, which just refers to the interaction of multiple identities in any individual. We accomplish this, in part, by using culturally relevant methods and doing our background research before we get into a new study. And of course, Minnesota Compass is one of the sources I often use to get a better sense of a community before I do any in-depth original research. So I hope I've helped you to understand a little bit more about why data disaggregation is important to social science research and how to do it well. Because it's methodologically a challenge and because we may not know which variables will help us to better understand which outcomes, I'm not advocating for universally disaggregating to the finest level of detail possible in every situation. Rather, I recommend careful disaggregation when it can be done well, and when the results will provide meaningful guidance for program and policy decisions. Thank you for your time.